As many of you know, on November 29th, 2023, Damarean Bible shot and killed Savannah Williams. On August 7th, a jury convicted Mr. Bible of intentional second-degree murder. I want to thank our team at the Hennepin County Attorney's Office for their thorough and compassionate work on this case, and they are over here, and the jury for their service. This morning, Judge Hoyos sentenced Mr. Bible to 367 months, which is 30 and a half years in prison. It is the maximum sentence that one could get on intentional second-degree murder. While nothing can change the fact that Savannah's family will have to live with the pain of her loss for the rest of their lives, we asked for an extensive sentence to ensure that Mr. Bible will not be able to harm anyone else. We are joined this morning by members of Savannah's family, as well as members of our Minnesota State Legislature. Savannah should still be here. This senseless act of violence against a Native and Cuban transgender woman has left a family without a daughter and sister, a partner without their person, and a community without the vibrant light that Savannah uniquely brought to every room she was in. Savannah deserved safety. I also want to acknowledge the loss that many in the community feel. Across the country and in our community, hateful acts of violence against transgender people are on the rise. Every time a trans person is attacked, the entire community feels less safe. Since 2013, at least 286 trans women have been killed, and 85% of them were trans women of color. We must work to combat this repulsive behavior, which is spurred on by increasingly violent and hateful rhetoric spreading like wildfire across this country. We are committed at the Hennepin County Attorney's Office to holding people accountable for you by using the tools available to us to protect public safety. We are also committed to fighting for better outcomes for members of the trans community in all aspects of their lives. We know that many Black, Brown, and Indigenous trans folks in Minnesota face barriers in housing, healthcare, and employment that create a revolving cycle of disparate outcomes. And it also makes them objectively less safe. We must work across all levels of government to ensure that we have the tools and resources necessary to protect and support our trans community. I am committed to collaborating with members of our state's legislature queer caucus who are here today and other elected and community leaders in this effort. Some of you have asked why we could not charge this case as a bias crime, given that Savannah was a member of our beloved trans community. To do that, we have to be able to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that Mr. Bible's motivation for this murder was bias. We did not have that evidence to meet that standard of proof. But the fact that we could not charge this as a bias crime does not change the impact that this crime has had on making our trans community feel less safe. Building safety is not a task done by one office alone. And I want to thank everyone who is committed to the work as we look to ensure this never happens again. My heart is with Savannah's family. I'm so deeply sorry for your loss. I want to invite Savannah's sisters, Gabrielle and Kelly Stilday, to the podium.
Hello, I'm Savannah's little sister. I wrote a little something. I never got to say goodbye to my big sister. But something I always remember she told me is to never say goodbye, to say see you later. I always remember everything she has done for me. She was my big sister. She always looked out for me. She was my protector. She mattered. She was here. She was a daughter. She was a sister. She was an aunt. Her nieces and nephews adored her. She loved them so much. He took that away from us. He took that away from our children. My family is not the same. We are broken, especially my mother. She has been living a nightmare. No mother should have to plan their son's funeral, their kid's funeral. No murderer should be granted leniency for their ill will. There is no good that comes from homicide. There is no light at the end of the tunnel. No feel-good lesson to be learned here. And for her murderer to make no effort to show 1 ounce of remorse for brutally and viciously murdering my big sister, Savannah didn't deserve to have her life taken. She is irreplaceable and it will not be forgotten because she gave us so much to remember. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Gabriel. I am Savannah's little sister. Bible took my sister from us, and there are no words to fully describe the deep of the pain we feel. Savannah was a beautiful soul, kind, loving, and a pillar of strength for our family. She was everything to me and my children, and we are devastated without her. He didn't just end Savannah's life. He tore apart a family, leaving wounds that may never heal. I want him to know that what he did was not just the act of violence. It was a choice that stemmed from a path of selfishness and disregard for the lives of others. He chose to fall into dark, lustful way of living, driven by harmful desires that led to this senseless murder. He allowed himself to be consumed by impulses that only destroy and devastate. It is critical that people understand the dangers of following this path, where unchecked desires leads to irreversible consequences and unimaginable pain for innocent people. His actions have forever stained our lives with grief. I hope he realizes the weight of what he's done, not just the life he ended, but the countless life he's damaged through his reckless decisions. My family and I will never be the same. I will never forgive or forget. While we try to move forward, our hearts will forever be marked by the loss. I hope he reflects deeply on the choices that led him here and understand that Savannah's life, filled in promise and love, was cut short because of them. People need to know the harm caused by such devastate behavior and strive for a different path. It shows you Savannah was a magnet. She pulled everyone towards her, including the defendant. People need to know to take a path that values love, respect, rather than one that leads to pain and loss. Thank you.
I want to invite Numi Big Bear, a community leader, to the podium.
Oh, sorry. Hello, everybody. My name is Numi Bad Boy. I'm a member of the Transgender Equity Council, and I'm a member of the Transgender Equity Summit planning team. You know, as I was walking up to meet the family, Savannah's sister told me that I look and reminded her of her sister. And I didn't know Savannah personally, but that alone just told me that we have more similarities than differences. And which is why I position myself in my life daily in the work in Minneapolis to do the work to create safety for trans people here in Minneapolis. I myself identify as two-spirited trans person, and I find it very necessary to do the work in Minneapolis because I am Savannah. You know, I'm a trans person of color, and I face those discriminations and those, you know, disparities that you know, were talked about earlier, and it is hard. It is hard being a transgender person, and I can only imagine, you know, what it was like. But so I'm here today to show my support and my love, and to continue the work that needs to be done here in Minneapolis for the transgender community here. Not only just the transgender community, but specifically the transgender community in of color. With that, thank you.
I want to invite Representative Lee Finke to the podium.
Good morning. My name is Lee Finke. I use she, her pronouns. I represent District 66A in the Minnesota House of Representatives, and I am the chair of the Minnesota Queer Legislators Caucus. I want to start by sending my sorrow to the family. We stood at a podium in December and talked about the tragic loss of Savannah's life. Nothing has changed since then. Savannah should still be alive. She would be alive if we had a society and a structure to take care of the people who we need to take care of. You know that violence against trans people is an epidemic in this country. And we know that that violence is significantly increased for people of color. Members of the indigenous and black communities face violence at rates far beyond what our white or cisgender peers face. In December, I said that if Savannah was not trans, she would still be alive. I still believe that that is true. And I, whether or not this is a crime that was bias motivated, what we know is true is that our trans people of color in the state of Minnesota, in the city of Minneapolis, around the country, are pushed to the edges of our society. And when we do not take care of the people who are under our care, tragic outcomes occur. We do not need to pretend. We do not need to ignore the facts. We can say the things that we know are true. Violence against trans people is an epidemic. It is increasing. It is fueled by a hatred that is based on fear, that is based on ignorance, and that is perpetuated by language, some of which we heard last night, built on lies and intended to lead to the outcomes that we are here today to mourn. So I just want to say for one more time, Savannah Williams should still be alive. She was a beloved member of the trans and two-spirit community. She was a beloved member of her family. She was a beloved member of the Tea Time ladies at Aliveness. Thank you to Aliveness for all of the services that you are providing to the people in our community who need them. Thank you to the county attorney and your office. I know that you take these crimes seriously. This is not the first major piece of violence committed against the trans community in the past year. It has been a hard year for queer people in the state of Minnesota. And we are going to continue to do what we can to improve the outcomes. But we can only do that if we stand together and be honest about what it means to exist in these communities and stand together to make sure that this stops. Thank you.
Representative Breon Curran.
Thank you. I'm Representative Breon Curran from House District 36B, Vice Chair of the Minnesota Legislators Queer Caucus. Again, Savannah should still be alive today. Our community continues to mourn this devastating loss, but we are resilient and we continue to heal. We hope that this sentencing will provide her family with some sense of closure, and thank the Hennepin County Attorney's Office for its tireless work on this case. As Vice Chair of the Minnesota Queer Legislators Caucus, I'm deeply committed to fostering a state where everyone feels safe, respected, and valued. The disproportionate violence faced by Black and BIPOC trans women is a devastating and urgent crisis. These community members are at an alarmingly higher risk of being victims of violence, often resulting in tragic and heartbreaking consequences. We must acknowledge the systemic factors contributing to this inequality and take decisive action to address this injustice. While the facts of each case are different, I was proud to author legislation this year banning the LGBTQ panic defense in our state. And I know we have great partners in the Hennepin County Attorney's Office dedicated to protecting LGBTQIA2S plus Minnesotans. As a member of the Public Safety and Judiciary Committees, I know the importance of ensuring our criminal justice system delivers accountabilities for all Minnesotans, regardless of sexual orientation or gender identity. All Minnesotans deserve to live their lives free from fear of discrimination, and I will continue working at the Capitol to ensure that is a reality in our state. Lastly, I want to thank organizations like the Aliveness Project, Gender Justice, and Out Front that stood with us in December when we first called for accountability in this case. And most of all, I want to thank Savannah's family for their bravery and untiring advocacy in this case. Thank you.
Questions?
Reasoning. It seemed like there was this kind of elusive element of trying to prove cause. Is that what you kind of noticed in this case?
I'll ask James Hanneman, who is lead counsel on this, to address that.
In many ways, we're helped by the fact we don't have to prove his motive, right? So proving that he did this crime was actually pretty easy. He was caught on surveillance video. They followed him right to his home. He admitted that he was the person who shot. And in some ways, those differing versions helped us prove that it wasn't self-defense, as he claimed, because his versions wouldn't shift at that if that were the truth. So we thought a lot about the why did he do this. And really getting to the heart of why he did it was hard because those versions shifted over time.
Any other questions?
Will there be anything coming up to memorialize her or come together?
Yeah, her one-year memorial will be coming up November 29th. We haven't got everything together, but her memorial will come up. Her one-year memorial will be up on November 29th. We haven't planned everything yet, but there will be a memorial for her.
Thank you.
Just a question.
I was just going to say the family would welcome people to come to that. So I think we'll try to get details out when we have more information about it.
Yes.
Sorry, Eric?
Oh, sure. This is a question for Representative Curran. Your bill, I know, passed the House, out of your committee. Where did it go after that? Can you update us on the stats?
So you're talking about specifically the LGBTQ panic defense ban? Yes, so that actually did pass into law. It was part of our public safety package in 2024.
Wide swath of organizations to protect communities that are pushed to these edges of society. Do you feel like the city and the county are finding ways to do that in the wake of a year that's been very difficult for queer people in Minnesota and Minneapolis?
I would say it's probably never enough. People need more resources. I think that's true of everyone. And I echo Representative Finke's comments about hateful rhetoric. We need to stop that. We need to stop that because unfortunately people do act on it. We don't know the motive of what happened in this case, but we know that assaults and violence against trans women are increasing across the country. And we need to stop that. And part of it is to stop talking about our trans folks as though they're not our beloved neighbors. Thank you.